Hello. So she said, my name is Joe Conway. I work for Crunchy Data. Been with Postgres community for quite a long time. I'm one of the committers. I'm on the PG infrastructure team and also a board member on PGUS. Just a disclaimer, this talk is very code heavy, source code heavy. A lot of the source code is actually R. It's obviously integrated with Postgres and PostGIS, as the abstract says. But you know, if we're looking for something a little higher level, this is probably not it. So hopefully I won't bore anyone with the details. I will have to go fairly quickly through the slides. Another point I'll make is that the slides are very complete in terms of you should be able to, after the fact, I'll post the slides, you should be able to cut and paste and basically follow along with what I did if you want to try and reproduce some of this. And that's one of the reasons I make the slides so detailed, is so that you can do that. The code is a combination of SQL and R. The other point is that there's more slides in this deck that I'm even going to try and deliver. There's like 17 slides or 18 slides that are in an appendix. So some of the details are actually at the end in the appendix, and I'll make note of where that is. So I'm going to do spatial analytics. I'll start out by covering an overview and then go into a section on how to ingest data, at least certain types of data. And then I'll go through some basic analytics. There's really not enough time in 1 hour to get anything near complete coverage on the possibilities here. So hopefully what I intend to do is show you how R might be integrated with these other things and be useful to you, and the fact that by using R, you actually gain a lot in terms of expressiveness because the ecosystem around R is so rich. So there's a lot of things that you can do with it. The background on the name of this talk, How Green Was My Valley, I was reading a book on R spatial analytics, not coincidentally, and it was talking about, in part of it, was talking about something called NDVI, Normalized Difference Vegetation Index. Basically, a vegetation index is one where you take satellite images, and in the satellite images, if you break out the color spectrums, it turns out that natural vegetation tends to be absorbed pretty completely in the visible range, but in the near infrared range, it's mostly reflected. And so you can take a combination of the visible and the near infrared and use that as a reliable index for how much vegetation is in the image that you've gotten from the satellite. And this NDVI itself is a specific calculation. It's right here. It's a normalized value. It's really supposed to be between -1 and 1, although in the presentation you'll see the values are going to show up between -10,000 and 10,000 because everything's been scaled up. And specifically, the product that I'm using in this talk is something called Mod 13A1. That's one of the image products that comes off of the MODIS satellites. Again, I'll show you a little bit more about this later on, where you can get this data from, how you can get it. There are other types of vegetation indexes. There are other products from the same satellites. There's actually multiple satellites that produce the same data. In this case, I took the data from the MODIS Terra satellite. There's also an Aqua satellite that just do the same thing, just at different times of the day, basically. In this data, there is different resolutions. So I'm using the 500 meter resolution. This is raster data, which basically means you've got, you can think of it as a grid on the ground every 500 meters, and there's a one point that represents that square. There is a 250 meter, which is a finer resolution, but of course that means the data is 4 times the size. So I chose the 500 meter because, one, they use that in the book, and two, I didn't really have enough disk space to start messing around, or patience really, to mess around with that. But if you wanted higher resolution, it is available, and as I said, there are other satellite products that do vegetation indexes that are probably more detailed as well.
Is that data available for free?
Yeah, I'm going to show you where you can get it. There's lots of applications for this kind of data. I also, as you'll see as I go through this, I'm doing this for my county in California, which is Southern California. We've had, you know, probably most people are aware there's been severe drought there for the last several years. So I thought it would be interesting to look at the vegetation over a period of time. I'm also going to cover in this talk a little bit about administrative shape data and some geocoded data. The components I'm going to use are Postgres, PostGIS, R, and PLR. So everyone here, I'm sure, knows what Postgres is, and probably everyone here knows what PostGIS is. How many people here are familiar with R? A good number. Okay, that's good. So R is specifically a statistical math processing language. But one of the reasons it's, to me, very interesting is the ecosystem of packages around this thing. If you look at the R CRAN, which is like equivalent to CPAN for Perl, let's say, right now there's over 10,000 packages available up there. Pretty much all of the cutting edge research in math and statistics is being developed for R before almost anywhere else. I mean, even SAS has R connectors these days. Oracle has an R connector, SAS has an R connector, because most of the newest kind of analytics is being developed in R first. The other interesting thing here worth mentioning is on their site, they do organize things by what they call these task views, because there are so many packages, it's hard just to find what packages you might want to use for different things. And if you go down there, there's things like machine learning, and there's, of course, spatial. So there's all of these different packages available just for doing spatial analysis, visualization, reading and writing of spatial data, point pattern analysis, geostatistics. So you can see it goes on and on and on. So to me, this is why I'm talking about R today. It's also why years ago I developed PLR, which is a plugin extension for Postgres that allows you to use R from a function within Postgres. So in terms of getting all this set up and ready to use, first you'd have to install your desired versions of Postgres and PostGIS and PLR, create a database, install the extensions, and then there's a variety of required packages just to do what we're doing in this presentation. As I just pointed out, there's a whole lot more you might want to potentially use. Just a note here that if you're going to try and follow along, install those R packages when you're logged in as root, or at least logged in as the Postgres user. And the reason for that is when PLR runs the R engine, it's doing so as the Postgres process, which means the Postgres user needs to be able to see those extensions to use them. If you install as root, then any user on the system would be able to see them because they'll go into the standard locations for the system. So we're just going to create a database called GIS, and then create extension PostGIS, create extension PLR. This is assuming the binaries have already been installed on your system, either from source or from RPM. Both of those things are available in the Postgres development group repository, for instance. So you can get Debians, you can get RPMs. On the R side, some of these extensions require Java, and I found it necessary to do this R command Java reconf, which basically just tells R how to find the JDK. And then this is kind of a neat thing about R too. You can, in one command, install.packages, you can install all of these packages in, on an analytics system. It'll actually prompt you for what mirror do you want. It'll go out to that mirror, download all the source code, and compile all of those libraries right on your system. I mean, maybe you like that, maybe you don't. You can also get most of these packages available through your normal vendor for wherever you get R. So if it's RPMs, I think they're in Apple probably. On Debian, they have quite a few of them as well. But you might need to do this for some libraries that are not available through your vendor. All right, so we're going to start out in terms of ingesting data. Any questions before I move on? So the first thing we're going to do is talk about how to ingest some data for administrative boundaries. So this is going to be vector data, so geometry type in PostGIS. There's a, a package called rgdal with a function called getData. And what this will do is it'll actually go out to well-known repositories of this kind of information on the internet and just download it for you right into your R session, which is pretty convenient and pretty cool. So in this case, we're going to use something called GADM, which is a global database of administrative boundaries. And there's a link there in case you want to go look at that. We're going to use that data from the R session to actually create a table, a PostGIS table. And just a note that this getData function also supports a database of climate data, a database of topographical data, and some other things. So there's links for that as well down here. So now here's our first example of this is a mixture of SQL and R because it's using PLR. So you can see this is the normal create or replace function that you would see for any function that you're creating in Postgres. I'm going to tell it I'm going to use some arguments. So I want a particular country and a particular level, and that's because this administrative shapes database is broken down by country and by level. And so you'll see down here, what I'm doing is I'm selecting country USA and level 2. What that means is I want to get, for the United States, all of the shapes of the states and the counties within the states, because level 2 is the counties. Or, you know, in some states they call them other things like parishes, but the equivalent is what would get pulled down. So I'll get all of those shapes all in one go. In order to do that, I have to load the library, the rgdal. I'm creating some connection strings, which will get used by these other functions. But this is where, you know, the rubber meets the road. This one function will pull all of that data off that website, put it into this variable shapes, and then this write OGR function will actually take that spatial data that's in the R session and write it out to a table in Postgres with a PostGIS geometry column. So this will end up looking like the table that this creates will look exactly like a table would look if you used shape to PGSQL function that comes along with PostGIS. It's basically one geometry column and a bunch of attribute columns. And amongst the attribute columns, there's going to be a name for state, and there's a name too for the county name, amongst other things. This function is using the OGR library, and it's actually using, in this case, I mean, there are other ways that might be, let me step back. As I went through writing this presentation, one of the things I realized is that, and I kind of knew this for a while, but PLR knows how to translate standard data types between Postgres and R. So things like integers and floats and even arrays are handled pretty transparently at a binary level. PostGIS is an extension. So PLR does not natively know how to translate a PostGIS geometry into a spatial object in R. So there's some workarounds in here that are probably not ideal, that are only exist because I've not gotten enough round to it to go make the modifications to PLR to make that a little bit more transparent. So this is one of those workarounds. This is actually going to go out to Postgres using the OGR library and directly create the table for me and load all that data into it.
So all the downloaded data is usually shaped by data, right?
Well, it's spatial data. You can use this same function to write it out into a shape file, which is a specific format also. And later on, I'm going to show you another example of a function that uses that because I want to present some timing performance information.
So your script,
that's what this is going to do. This is going to connect back to Postgres using a regular connection.
Would there be a way to just tell it connect to this instance instead of passing all the...
That would require me to modify PLR, which is what I just talked about. I would like to do that at some point. I just haven't done that yet.
My question is,
It's a function of the database. In order to do it directly, I would have to make modifications at the C level to use an interface called SPI. And I have not done that. So in this case, it was, for the purposes of creating this presentation, it was a lot easier. And it doesn't take long to run this. It takes a couple seconds to create this table. I mean, running this function takes a couple seconds, basically. And it creates the table. And then basically here, this query here, which is creating an additional index on basically state name and county name, that is actually, this dbget query is executing that string. That is actually happening through SPI, because PLR knows how to do that. So calling this function like this is going to create a table called counties using the data from the US down to the county level. So now let's see what it looks like to actually do something. Let's plot this thing. There's going to be a couple of different methods that I use for creating plots and saving them in a way that I can use them. That's intentional. I wanted to show you alternative ways that you might do that. The first way is that if you return byte A from a PLR function, whatever object was returned from the R side gets serialized and sent out as binary, basically. So in this case, there's some code here, this part here, and basically these two lines here are setting up a buffer in memory so that when the plot gets rendered, it gets rendered to that buffer, and then that entire buffer gets returned. So basically, the image just gets streamed back to the client in this case. So this is one method you can use to generate a graphic using PLR and then capture that graphic for later use, whether it's displaying it on a website or if you want to write it out to a file or you want to store it in a table somewhere, you can do any of those things.
So all formats are supported, like PNG, JPEG?
The standard formats are supports, yes. So in this case, what I'm doing here, first I have to set up a projection string that represents the data that I got. Anyone here not familiar with projection strings, or the idea of projections? Everyone pretty much familiar with it? Okay, great. Again, what I'm doing here is I'm selecting out of that geometry column, out of that table that I created just a minute ago. And I'm going to have to, and again, this is the weakness. This is the part that I haven't fixed yet in PLR, but I'm converting that geometry to a well-known text format, and then I'm going to basically take that well-known text and read it back into R right here, and then just plot. So it's just a single command, plot, that'll generate the plot. So this is what the outline of San Diego County looks like. This other bit here is a function that I provided, because when you get the serialized R object back out as bytes, there's actually a little bit of wrapper that R puts around the image itself when it stores it internally. And this PLR get raw strips that off. So you wind up with, by taking this with the output of that function, you get exactly the image. Now, later on, I'm going to need to make use of what's called a reprojection. It sounds like everyone here is kind of familiar with that idea. But basically, when you've got kind of a 2D image, a projection is how you want to render what's really a three-dimensional object of something that's laid out on the globe as a two-dimensional object. And it turns out that this MODIS data that I was talking about earlier has a different projection than this administrative data. The MODIS satellite data is raster data, as I said, which means it's a bunch of data points in an equally spaced grid. But these points are three-dimensional vector points. You could actually reproject the raster data to the administrative data, but if you do that, because of the equal spacing and everything, when the spacing changes, you'd have to extrapolate. So you'd end up having some loss of fidelity by doing that. So you're better off if you reproject the vector stuff into the projection of the raster. So that's what this is doing here. And again, as you can see, it's just a single R command, which is, again, very similar. It should look familiar to you if you've ever done this in PostGIS. It's just SP transform. over that data and then plot it, and now it looks a little different, right? And that just has to do with the perspective of the satellite. So there's a couple other alternative methods that I could use to get this data. I could use, basically, I wrote out the exact same data as shapefiles. And in this case, this will just read from the shapefile instead of from Postgres into the shapes object, and then I can just subset that to get just the county, the state and the county that I want from shapes and plot that. Or another way I could do it is I could read back into Postgres using this read OGR and essentially pull the whole table in using read OGR. But you'll see it doesn't make sense to do that. The original method that we used was quite efficient because all we did was grab just the data that we wanted for San Diego County and pass that from Postgres to R, whereas in the other two cases, we basically had to render the entire layer and then just subset it and pick out the piece that we wanted. And that was actually one of the reasons I wanted to kind of do this presentation in the first place, is because as I was reading through people doing this in pure R, that's what they tend to do, is they tend to do something more like one of these two methods, because they read everything, an entire layer into an object, and then they subset it in R, and there's no index to help. Okay, so now I'm gonna move on from the administrative layer stuff to geocoding. Any more questions about the administrative layer? The third data type I'm gonna ingest is actually raster data. So who here does not know what geocoding means? Anyone? So the idea of geocoding is you basically start out with like a postal address and you wanna convert it into spatial data, which is more of a lat and a long, right? So there's some services available, and again, there's an R package called ggmap, and it has the option to either use Google Maps API or something called the Data Science Toolkit. Just to note, these are both something that you can use kind of for your own use. They're not intended for commercial use. They're limited in the number of queries you can run per day. So, I mean, for commercial use, it may not be the best method, but you can do this like 2,500 times a day on Google Maps, and I think 10,000 a day for the Data Science Toolkit. So the process that I'm going to use here is I'm going to create a list of addresses for some points of interest. I'm going to use that library to go geocode those. I'm going to add some names to them. I'm going to set a coordinate reference system so I know what projection it's in. And then I'm going to create another one of these PostGIS tables using that OGR function. So this is what it looks like. I'm going to, you know, again, this stuff is, when you're doing it in R, is fairly straightforward. This geocode function, you pass in the array of addresses that you want geocoded as an array here to Postgres, to the Postgres function, and that just becomes a vector that gets passed to this geocode function, and now that creates my layer with lat longs for each of those. And then I'm going to add to it an array which becomes a vector of the names of those points. So I just combine that. Now, essentially, I've got what's called a data frame in R. And now if I tell, shouldn't be so loud. If I tell R now that long and lat attributes of this data frame are actually the coordinates, that converts it into a special data type in R called a spatial data frame, so that all of these other functions within R know how to work. How many have I tried? In here, I tried 3. I didn't do a ton of them. You mean how fast is it? I've not tried to do any kind of performance test. And like I said, it's limited to 2,500, so if you're using the Google API. No, I didn't try 2,500. I tried 3, and it was very fast. But I mean, if I had tried 3 and it was very slow, then that would tell you something anyway. So
it's not going to fly for that
It'd be interesting to try. I maybe after this talk, I'll go try it. So you set the projection string, and then use this write OGR again to create a table with the data, and then I'm also going to create an index on it. So the same as before. And then when I call the function, I'm just passing in these two arrays. These are three addresses. These are three airports that happen to be in San Diego County. And the layer name is going to end up being the name of the table that it creates. So now when I want to plot those, I've switched here. So before I was doing PLR functions, now I'm showing you how you might do this in just straight R. Just the thing to note here is if you basically take everything below, you know, this function decoration part here, you could just cut and paste that into a PLR function and it would become something that you would run through PLR. When you're first doing this kind of thing, you probably want to do it interactively until you figure out what it is that you want to do. And then once you're kind of happy with what you're doing, at that point you might want to bottle it up into PLR so that it's kind of more controlled once it's been QA'd, vetted, whatever. So, and the other change I made here is I'm passing in the name of a file for my image, and I'm basically saying if that file name is not empty, I'm going to set things up so that R just creates the file on disk. So instead of streaming it back, it's just going to create it on disk. Just another method to do the same thing. So this is similar to what we were doing before. I'm just selecting the data out of the table for the areas of the area of interest table, and that's my county outline. And then on top of that, I'm going to read the data for those points of interest. And again, the nice thing about R is what I can do here is I can plot the San Diego County outline and then go grab the other data and then just call plot again, and it just, I say add equals true and it just adds it to the plot. So now I'm just adding another layer to the plot. So this is a fairly small function, and now I'm plotting San Diego County, and it's maybe a little hard to see, but there's three red dots here, and those are my three points of interest in my area of interest. So now we'll talk about the NDVI download. There's a lot of text on here. I'm not going to try and go through it in like great detail, but the idea is this is where you go get this data. It's called the USGS site. It's usgs.gov. It's Earth Explorer. And there's an interface here. It logged me out because I wasn't active. Basically, all this area on the left here is where you're going to enter all the criteria. And then it'll select, based on your criteria, which things you want to download. And then you're going to go through and check them off and say, yeah, I want to download all of these things. So that's what this is kind of walking you through, what I did. You do need to get a login to their site if you want to be able to download the information. It's free. I set Alameda County as my search criteria. And what it does is it will, you pick a point somewhere within one of the satellite images, and it'll basically give you the satellite images that cover that point. When I originally put San Diego County in there, it turned out that it was far enough south in the US that there were actually two different passes of the satellite that got San Diego County. So I ended up with twice as much data, and it was redundant, and I didn't really want it. So I ended up using a Northern California county just so that it would get me just the continental US. I ended up downloading all of the data from 2000 through the end of 2016. Basically, these satellite passes are done, they're constantly being done, but then the data gets aggregated into, like, they say 16-day intervals, but it's actually more frequent than that. It's more like every 6 days. And so over the course of 6 days, they'll have multiple passes and even multiple passes per day. And what they try and do is boil the data down so that, because as you can imagine, with satellite data, sometimes you're looking at clouds. You're not getting good data. So they keep taking the images, and then they take like 6 days worth of these images, and they go and they figure out before they even give it to you what's the best pixel out of that time frame that represents this area for that time period. So you'll end up getting a raster where each pixel may come from a different satellite image. And they kind of keep track of all that, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a minute. But the bottom line is, this ends up being 104 gigs of data that you're downloading, you know, just at the 500 meter resolution. If I had done the 250 meter, it would have been like 400 and something gigabytes. And it took like 12 hours to download. They provide you with an application to do the downloading. It actually retries and does all kinds of fancy things, so it was kind of convenient, but it took a long time to download it. So this is the area of interest. There's a spot on here where you can actually click, and it says show footprint for the image that you're currently looking at. And this is the area that the satellite is collecting, basically. And remember, we just want one little patch out of there. This is a screenshot of the downloading app. So, you know, like I said, it's just a small Java app. It lightweight, worked pretty well. Probably wouldn't be very easy to get this data without something like this. I ended up with 1,166 individual zip files to download for that, to cover that period of time for 16 years. So in terms of processing the data, the process basically, you know, one of the things I realized pretty quickly is that this is real life. Not all the data was good. So out of 1,166 files, 9 of them were actually bad. And, you know, I first discovered that as I was looping through to unzip them and I'd get errors. But then I quickly realized that if you just kind of looked at that directory and look for the files that were sort of an anomalous size, so they were all bad, because all the rest of them were pretty much the same size. So the first thing I had to do was clean out the ones that were bad. This pre-processing function, which I definitely am not going to try and go through, it's probably, you know, 80 or 100 lines of R code, so it's not a huge bunch of code, but it's too much to go through in detail here. But this is the basic process. Load that area of interest, or the San Diego County boundary again. Reproject that to the raster data projection. And then loop through the downloaded files. You unzip them. You get 3 different rasters out of that. You get this NDVI data that I've been talking about, but you also get a QA raster and an acquisition raster. The QA raster basically, on a pixel-by-pixel basis, tells you whether it thinks the data was good. So basically, if the QA raster pixel equals 0, it means the data in the NDVI raster corresponding to that pixel was considered to be good. There are various levels of degradation, but basically anything that wasn't a 0, I marked it as NA, which in R terms is basically like making it a null. And then this acquisition raster has to do with the exact date that pixel was acquired on, because as I said, in one file, there may be 6 different days and different acquisitions per day. So I ended up using the acquisition dates. I converted them into year dot fraction of year based on number of days, and then taking an average for the entire raster and saying, all right, for this raster layer that I'm going to save, this was the average date, basically represented as a float. And as I said, I NA'd all of the pixels that were not good from the QA data, but I also used that San Diego boundary to crop the raster data. So cropping is basically, you take, you know, essentially a square the minimum square that fits around that shape, and throw away everything else completely. But then in addition to that, I also did something called a mask operation, which in addition, now everything that's still outside of the boundary of San Diego County got marked NA. The reason I did that is because now when I do any calculations on that raster, I'm only looking at data that's inside the county boundaries. And then after doing all that looping, what I end up with, and again, I could have done this differently, but I end up, each loop, I now have basically San Diego County, NDVI, for that that NDVI file and I stack them into what's called a raster brick. So it's a bunch of layers in one raster that I end up writing out to a file. And I could have used PostGIS to write it out to a table. It didn't feel like it was worth it given the way I was using it. It's probably something for some future version of this. The other thing this function does is it returned all of those calculated dates and the file names that were associated with them, because that turned out to be very useful for debugging. And it sends that back to Postgres as a byte A, a binary. So again, it's a data frame in R that gets converted to binary, and I just store that in a table for later use. So this is what the header and the footer of that function look like. As I said, that's in the appendix. This is what it looks like in terms of calling it. I create this R objects table, which is where I'm going to store that date time associated with the raster layers. I call the function, insert the result back into this table. That took a little bit over 2 hours to run on those 1,157 files. Now, this is basically, if you take the plotting that we saw earlier and we overlay some additional information that includes the NDVI. So now I'm going to reproject everything to the NDVI projection. I'm going to actually acquire a layer from the NDVI. And when I plot that thing, this is what it gets. So you saw this pretty much earlier in the reprojected form. There's my three points of interest for the airports, but now it's overlaid with the NDVI area. And so you can see, you know, the green areas are the ones with more vegetation. Okay, so as I said earlier, when I did the processing of all that NDVI data, I returned the dates and the file names to Postgres, but I also wrote out that raster brick as a geotiff. So rather than storing it as a raster data in Postgres, I kind of cheated. I just put it into a file. That was easy to do. It was actually pretty quick. So this is reading in that TIFF file in order to get the NDVI data. So this is frame 42 out of 1,157. So this is just one example of it. So now this is a kind of a helper function that I just give it the name of the object I want to pull out of the table that I stored the R objects in, and it'll just return me that object. As an aside, PLR supports this PLR modules table. There's actually been some talk on the list lately about alternative ways to do this, but for now, this is what PLR does. Basically, if you create this table and create a function, an R function, you insert it directly into that table. When R gets initialized, it will instantiate. It'll compile that and put it into the environment. So now this becomes a helper function that I can call from my PLR functions. And what this one is going to do is it's going to take that floating point representation of the date and actually turn it into an actual date. So then this function takes the byte A input, which now is now inside of R, becomes a data frame again, and it's going to use format and my little helper in the PLR modules table to actually output all this data as a date. So now I have access to all the data that was in that binary object that I returned from R earlier. So let's take a look at what does NDVI look like as an average over time. In this case, I'm passing in, again, the name of that raster file with all my layers in it. The cell stats function will take this function here and apply it to each of the layers. So I'm going to take the mean, basically, of the entire layer. So all of San Diego County, I'm going to find the mean of the NDVI value for the county over time, and I'm going to plot it. Well, in this case, I'm actually just going to return it. So this is just an example of the first three. In this function, I'm going to take it one step further. I'm actually going to plot that data along based on time. So this is now you can start seeing, all right, this is what my dryness or my vegetation in San Diego County looks like from 2000 through 2016. And you can kind of get a sense that there's a, you know, there's some upward trends and some downward trends that kind of make sense. But there's another way you can do this with R, using a different plotting function called ggplot. And in particular, it supports this thing called geomsmooth. When I plot that, it actually automatically does geometric smoothing for me. So it's a geometric moving average smoothing, and now you can definitely see that there's a trend in the downward direction in terms of vegetation index. So now there's just a couple other visualizations I'm gonna do here. I'm gonna do average by month. So a lot of this is the same stuff we've been seeing in here. I'm just looping through 12 months of one particular year that was given as an argument. And for each month, I'm gonna take all of the data for that month and average it together, pixel by pixel now. Instead of all of the pixels in one raster, every pixel is gonna get averaged together for all of the data that came from one month. So now, and again, I'm just calling plot once, but since I built a raster brick with 12 layers and I plot it, I get 12 plots. So this is January through December, and you can kind of get a sense for it's, you know, greenest in the winter, and then as you move on toward August, it gets considerably drier. And this happens to be 2011, which was the peak of the wet season that we saw in that trend data. Now, if I do the same thing, except I do a particular month across all of the years, now I have one for each. So this is January from 2001 through 2016. And you can see the kind of the progression in January of how it gets drier and then wetter again and then drier. And then this is, it's kind of a nice contrast. If you go from January to August, you can see how much that changes. So that's it. Any questions? I think I have a few minutes left.
We have 8 minutes.
8 minutes for questions.
Well, my first question would be, obviously, I saw a lot of dot, dot, dot. So are there more complete code samples later on the slides? Or can you find them online somewhere?
Well,
Yeah.
If you go back to this function, these dots here are just mean it's continuing on to this. So this is complete. That's a complete function there. It just won't fit on one slide. This one, what I'm showing is everything kind of above and below this part is the same as it was in that function. All I really did was I replaced this looping part with a different looping. And you know, back in, like this is fairly complete. But this is pure R. This is not a PLR function here. This function is complete. When you saw this part, if you earlier we had another plot point of interest function earlier in the slide deck. And again, everything that's dot, dot, dot is the same as before. And these bits were added to it. And then finally, that the loop processing that I was talking about of the actual raster data is kind of, yeah, this is, it's all the way at the back after the appendix in this pre-processing function. So if you wanted to look through that, there's some additional information about how that data all works.
Is there any way to store the data? I mean, obviously we're masking the administrative boundaries to reduce the amount of work that R had to do. Is there any way to store that data masked? I mean, you're using PNG, so you can use transparency layer there, or is there any way to output it that way, or?
I'm not sure I'm following that question.
Well, I'm just saying you mask the data based on the
the San Diego County boundary.
Marks based on your maximum extents.
Right.
And then you mask the data based on the administrative boundaries of San Diego County.
Mm-hmm.
So you wouldn't have to do that than necessary. Is there any way to store the image with that masking, like as a transparency in PNG or some other thing?
I created that raster brick as a file, but I could have created PostGIS supports raster layers.
Okay.
So I could have stored that in a table in Postgres. And in fact, you could have not done all of this subsetting. You could have stored the entire original image in PostGIS and then done the subsetting kind of at runtime so that you could do San Diego County now and, you know, some other county on the East Coast tomorrow.
I think all the deep stuff that you did, you could have done in PostGIS directly, right?
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of ways to do all of this stuff, and I could have stored a lot more data in Postgres. I just didn't really want to consume the room on my hard disk, which didn't really have enough room on it. You know, I downloaded 100 gigs of files, and if I had loaded that all on a Postgres database, it would have been at least another 100 gigs, maybe more. But the nice thing about being able to go back and forth between PostGIS and R is that, you know, as I said, R has got tons of different libraries that you could potentially apply to this data.
Very nice example overall. I just have a question. Have you thought about what would it take to kind of operationalize a solution like this in terms of being it something that an end user without all the knowledge about this code can access and be running on some Postgres instance somewhere?
I haven't really thought about it. I mean, I tried to write these functions in a generic way so they weren't, you know, hard coded to return San Diego County.
Yeah.
So you could kind of take what's here and extend it to a degree.
Are there any missing pieces that you're aware of already in terms of
I don't know if you're familiar with GRASS, but there's an open source library called GRASS that also can tie into R. It also uses a lot of the same underlying libraries, and it's open source, and R can tie into GRASS as well. So that's kind of a GUI layer for this kind of stuff. There are other, you know, there's a QGIS is like a GUI for doing geographic editing. There's of course commercial products like ArcServe from Esri. But you know, this is all about trying to automate the processing, because you know there's certain things that lend themselves to hand operations, and then there are other things where you don't want to do it by hand. Anything else? All right, thanks.